On Story is brought to you in part by the Alice Clayburgh Reynolds Foundation, a Texas family providing innovative funding since 1979. Funding also provided by John Paul and Eloise DeJoria. On Story, presented by Austin Film Festival. A look inside the creative process from today's leading writers and directors.
The key is to invest the audience in the journey that the characters are going on. So it's not even so much a matter of what the outcome will be, but, you know, what it's going to be like for them in reaching that conclusion. And how will they be once they get there? In the broadest terms, maybe they'll live, maybe they'll die, but will they be broken? Will they have lost something that we care about? Will they be, you know, vindicated or validated in some way? What is the human journey going to be?
When I actually went to Houston and was researching it for the first time and met with the mission controllers actually in the old mission control room, one of the things that immediately became apparent to me, and it was a real revelation and changed the way I approached the film, was somebody described the circumstance as though they were MASH doctors, you know, 2 miles off the front lines, and somebody had been dragged in and plopped on their table dying, and it was their buddy from boot camp. And that's the way they felt about these three guys. And I looked around, there were 14 mission controllers there, and then I talked to them some more afterward, and that was so clearly the case. And it kind of, in addition to being a survival story, it became a rescue story. And I thought that added a tremendous dimension. In terms of directing the scenes in Mission Control, that's what we began with on the film. And I carefully put together a group of actors. I also simply said, as actors, you know, much of the detail is not scripted, but I want nonstop activity. And the more thorough you are, and I want it authentic. So if something's just kind of doesn't make much sense, I'm going to cut it out. But we're going to have two cameras going all the time, and you know, the mission controllers who look the most alive are going to get the most screen time. They suddenly made good friends with people like Jerry Bostick.
Econ, what's your data telling you?
O2 tank 2 not reading at all. Tank 1 is at 725 psi and falling. Fuel cells 1 and 3 are oh boy, what's going on here? Flight, let me get back to you.
Flight GNC?
GNC. Flight, they're all over the place. They keep yawing close to gimbal lock.
I keep losing radio signal. Flight, their antenna
right,
must be
22. They're going to have to do it manually.
One at a time, people. One at a time. One at a time. Ecom, is this an instrumentation problem, or are we looking at real power loss here?
It's reading a quadruple failure. That can't happen. It's got to be instrumentation.
We also use the transcripts a lot. We would took the scenes that were concisely written, and we would often build them out into two, or you know, it'd be like a half a page of dialogue achieving the dramatic aim, but we would build it out into 2 or 3 minute scene that basically encompassed much of what we were learning about through the transcripts. And so the first cut of the movie was extremely long, and we had to take much of it back to more or less what was scripted, but it was infused with this air of authenticity, and all the actors in the capsule and all the actors in Mission Control really knew what the procedures were about, and they were following them. And so it gave it a kind of a a logic that I think resonates.
You know, I do think it's who you're doing it on, because there's different levels. I mean, I think in all of our cases, if it's not exactly what happened, that's fine. But if you're doing something on, like, JFK, it's a different level that you... I mean, who gives a shit if I make stuff about Mickey Ward and Dickie Eklund? I mean, that you want to stay true. You know, obviously, I think you do owe something to the truth. If there was... And I think we tried to. Certainly, Dickie was a squirrely character, and he'd done time, and he'd maybe or maybe not killed somebody. So it's sort of like you have to get a sense that you're not presenting that character like he's a saint. You owe something to that, but you don't necessarily owe something to the literal truth. I think it does depend on what that character and what that story is. There are some stories that level, you have to have a higher standard.
When I talk about exactly the issue we're talking about today, I use his film as a reference point, because if that was a fictional film, the two brothers, I'm sorry, Dickie's the right?
Yeah,
Dickie. Mickey would not take Dickie back as his trainer. Everything in the film says he needs to get rid of Dickie in order to move on. He's got a wonderful woman now. He doesn't need his brother. His brother's going to destroy his life. And then he takes Dickie back? Well, it's great, because it feels real. You're going like, holy, this is exactly what human beings do. And I'm afraid it's going to him up again. He's going to lose again because he did that. But he doesn't lose. He wins. And we're feeling like... You get that goosebump feeling that you have in real life when things don't quite make sense, but at another visceral level, they do.
Dickie's a junk bag.
Hey.
He's a junk bag.
You, Sean. I'm 8 months sober.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I'm sure you're going to need something for something now that you're out. Oh, my back. Oh, my back.
You always picking on. Huh? And what about O'Keefe? We're in the same boat. And one day at a time, right, O'Keefe? You and me. But what? It's all right for him to be here? Why am I the problem? I'm his blood. I'm his family.
I'm the one fighting, okay? Not you, not you, and not you. I know what I need.
And you need Dickie?
I want Dickie back. And I want you, Charlene. And I want O'Keefe. I want my family. What's wrong with that?
I was fortunate that Mickey and Dickie kept calling me, which they still do, and I have their messages. And the amazing is...
They're still working on the film, Scott?
Yeah. They're working on Fighter 2. But the, and I'm not kidding. But the, But the dynamic still exists between them. The reality is it never changed. It's the same dynamic. And I would keep those messages on my machine, and I would be able to go back and play them. And I could write anything in their voice now because you couldn't make that stuff up. And that dynamic, I know almost with every scene they come to now how those guys would react. It's like sort of, you couldn't, and with any other character I've created myself, I would never know that.
The experts in the space program said, well, you know, this was not really the way it was. This was not, you know, there was 125 different little defects of this movie. And like, you know, Lovell didn't have a red Corvette. He had a blue Corvette, you know, things like that. But if you see the final sequences of the movie, which you just saw, where we had to do the manual burn, and the Earth is in the background, the film is being shot with the behind the vehicle, and you can see the flames coming out of the engine, and we're moving back and forth like this to try to get on the proper course.
She's burning.
Oh, yeah.
That's her arm off.
Okay, here we go.
Unit regulators on. RTS is go, 10% thrust.
Bring her on. Actually, that was not the case. We were burning vertical to the way we're coming into the Earth, because we had to change the angle coming in to make a safe landing. And when I mentioned that to Ron as a consultant, and he said, it's a lot more dramatic to show you coming this way.
One of the challenges is, how do you keep that suspense when we all know they do get up and they do get down? And Ron and I were talking about this earlier, is that part of the thing we considered from the beginning was a kind of tripod, with the capsule being one, mission control being the other, and the family being the third. And the key being that although we know what happens to the people in the capsule, the people in mission control and the people at home don't know. And so part of the brilliance of what Ron and everyone did was to make the drama to those people so powerful that the audience becomes them. I mean, you look at that liftoff, that extraordinary sequence, and to me, the emotion always hits when they cut to that two shot of Marilyn Lovell and Fred Hayes' wife. And that's where the emotion comes in, because suddenly I'm feeling what they're feeling.
Yes, sir. We have cleared the tower at 13:13.
Okay, guys, we got it.
And you might sort of have an idea about, you know, what the outcome might be. You might have a sense that it's going to be okay. But in movies, you often have a sense it's probably going to be okay. The idea of really investing in, personally, what the journey meant to them individually, starting with the Mattingly swaggered switch, starting with Lovell's desperate need to want to go, and getting the mission, and it's frightening Marilyn, his wife, and all of those very human touchstones that we can all relate to. By identifying that and really building on it, it creates suspense. And the idea is to sort of get the audience off of the big picture and follow the details. And what price are they paying enduring this thing? What's it cost? What's the test like to their character, to who they are? Are they going to make it? How are they going to hold up emotionally in addition to physically?
I think you have to empathize with your characters and sort of feel for them. I mean, I think the journalist take for me was just sort of, I'm going to interview you and try to find your story and be a parasite in that way and sort of see what you can get. But I think you have to care about your characters.
Yeah, I mean, I also would have used the word empathy rather than sympathy. You become your characters, whether they're real or not. You are inside those people, and you have to find who they are. And I think sympathy means, again, it creates this level of obligation. You know, I need to present this person a certain way because that's what they would want.
You have to sort of be inside your character in a way to sort of write them. Not only looking over your shoulder, right, but sort of like, I'm there with that person. That's why some people are impossible to really know. I mean, to me, like an example of that, a movie that does that amazing is Amadeus. I mean, how could anybody feel like Mozart? I mean, you know, there's like, no, you couldn't. I couldn't anyways understand that level of genius. But everybody, Soliari, everybody feels like I'm a loser, right? It's like, I could write that character and then his way into the other character. So it's trying to figure out that way in to what you're going to write.
With Conviction, I had two big challenges. The villain, Officer Nancy Taylor, who was played by Melissa Leo, I don't understand this woman. It just was inexplicable. And when Melissa Leo sat down with me and she said, I don't understand her, I said, I'm sorry, I can't really help here. And she made up a backstory to help her, you know, and I listened to the backstory and I said, well, I don't really think that's what happened, but if it works for you, it works for me. And so that was difficult. To try to grab onto something and, you know, figure out what makes this person a human being.
Why aren't you a cop anymore? I left the force when I got married. Really? You mean it had nothing to do with you framing another cop? I beg your pardon? What was his name? Oh, yeah, Stanley Randall. He found out that you were dirty, so you got a waitress from the Rusty Scupper to accuse him of rape. Is that what they told you over there? I'm sure you can imagine what it was like to be the only woman on that police force. I wasn't dirty. And the rape charge wasn't false.
I don't know how to really embody that level of denial and self-justification. So that was just, I couldn't figure out what made her tick, which for me as a writer is difficult. I need to understand and be able to analyze my characters and where they're coming from, even if I don't approve of where they're coming from.
I love to write villains, you know, it's like the bad part of yourself. I mean, I always feel like, you know, when you're writing something, you kind of fracture yourself into all your characters. So that if you were to put all those characters together, that would be a snapshot of who you, Scott, is at that one particular moment in time. Well, for me, like, you know, I'm a nice person, but, you know, I have a lot of horrible thoughts. And, you know, so when I'm writing a villain, I'm getting to exercise that part of myself. So I've written people who've shot children, and, you know, I don't have any problem writing them. You know, like, they think they're doing the right thing. I mean, to me, everybody believes they're doing the right thing. And if you can just see from their perspective, you know, she thought, you know, the DNA evidence is wrong. You know, she's seen, you know, these cops up and they collect evidence improperly, and, you know, therefore the evidence is wrong. You know, whatever it may be, or, you know, they have a justification and they think they're right. To me, it's a blast.
You know, doing a biopic, you can't tell somebody's whole life, but trying to just tell what part of that person's life you're going to tell and what that story is, you have to sort of figure out, okay, like, what is the story? Not only is going to make the best movie, but what is sort of your life about? As from my point of view, sort of what is that thing that sort of makes it why you want to tell a movie and what you're going to see, but what is that story of your life that I want to tell?
The truth is your friend. meaning that the truth will give you details that you couldn't get away with if you were writing a fictional screenplay, an original screenplay. And they will allow for deviations of character, for peculiar events, for side events that seem peripheral but then lead back to the main story. When you can, you want to take advantage of everything you possibly can in the true story.
Hi, my name is Daniela Sherer, and I'm the animator and director of the short film Overnight Stay. The film is an animated documentary about an experience my grandmother had when she was a teenager. And my grandmother is a Holocaust survivor, and this film is about her time in Krakow in Poland in 1941. The most difficult thing about making this film is really trying to understand what it was like to live in a different place, a different time, and really to put myself in my grandmother's shoes in order to tell the story and understand it emotionally. So what I hope audiences will take away from this film is really what I take away from my grandmother's story, which is knowing that a really, really small or even mundane act of kindness towards someone who might be in a low point in their life or in trouble can make a really huge difference. It can have such a profound effect on them that even they might remember it for the rest of their lives, really. Coming up is my short film, Overnight Stay. Thank you very much for watching.
Glaubst du, dass Leute von Natur gut oder schlecht sind?
Weil so ein 83 Jahre ist viel Zeit und man erlebt vieles. Und wenn man gutes Gedächtnis hat, da oft legt man sich ins Bett und bearbeitet das alles. Nicht? Ich habe so viele Erinnerungen, die sitzen so fest im Kopf, dass ich das immer weiß. Kann ich mich erinnern, dass in 1941 so, da war ich dann 17 Jahre alt. Dann sind wir gekommen nach Krakau, auch zu einem Freund von meinem Vater. Und die haben uns aufgenommen, alle vier, und haben uns gegeben ein Zimmer. und das Zimmer war verschlossen. Und dort musste man manchmal ganz ruhig sein, wenn jemand Fremde in der Wohnung war. Und mein Vater hat sehr klug gemacht, weil er hat ein bisschen Geld bei verschiedenen Leuten gelassen. Da waren noch Juden, die von Ghetto zu arbeiten gekommen sind nach Krakau, und die haben die Geschäfte noch geführt, aber haben keine Macht gehabt über das Geld. Die haben nur dort arbeiten müssen. Und ich bin dorthin gegangen, habe sie getroffen. Und ich wollte mit dem Geld zurückkommen am Abend zu der Wohnung, und ich konnte nicht reingehen. Weil unten stand so ein junges Paar. Und die sollten nicht sehen, dass ein Fremder kommt hier rein, sonst hätte ich für meine Mutter und die zwei Schwestern verraten. Und die waren immer drauf, eine Aussage bei Deutschen. Da haben sie dafür doch Geld gekriegt, wenn sie einen Juden getroffen haben, den man noch umbringen kann. Und so bin ich gegangen, und da habe ich eine Adresse gehabt, wo eine Frau Schwarzhandel gemacht hat. Und die hat auch angenommen, Leute zu übernachten. Und da bin ich dort gegangen, ich musste doch irgendwo über Nacht bleiben. Und da bin ich rein. Und ich habe mich natürlich ausgegeben als Pauline. Und da habe ich gesagt, dass meine Familie ist weg. Man hat sie nach Deutschland genommen zu arbeiten. Und ich will auch nach Deutschland gehen arbeiten. Ich habe ihr gesagt, ich habe kein Geld. Und sie hat gesagt, wenn ich ihr die Küche sauber mache, brauche ich ihr nicht bezahlen. Und ich habe ihr die Küche sehr sauber gemacht. Das war wahnsinnig dreckig, weil sie hat mit Hühnern gehandelt und sind die Hühner spazieren gegangen und haben natürlich ihre Zeug gelassen. Die sind nicht ins Klo gegangen. Und dann hat sie mir gegeben so ein Feldbett, weißt du, so wie bei Soldaten haben so Feldbetten, wenn sie irgendwo sind. Und die hat sie gesagt, da kann ich schlafen. Und hat mir eine Zudecke gegeben. Es war aber Winter und war kalt. Ich habe geschlafen, habe festgehalten, das, was ich bei mir hatte. Und in der Nacht ist die Frau aufgestanden, und ich habe bemerkt, dass sie mich mit noch etwas zudeckt. Und da hat sie so ein Pelzdecke gehabt, weißt du, wo man vor den Betten manchmal hat, so ein Tier. Und hat mich mit dem zugedeckt, und das war so schön warm. Und ich habe angefangen zu heulen. Aber das war schön von ihr.
Ja. Glaubst du, dass Leute von Natur gut oder schlecht sind?
In jedem Menschen steckt ein Sadist. Wenn es zum Ausbruch kommt, kann man nicht wissen, wie der reagiert. Jeder Mensch kann gut sein und schlecht. Natürlich gibt es gute Menschen oder schlechte. Im Krieg kann ich mich nur erinnern an den Menschen, was mir geholfen haben. Es waren natürlich die guten Sachen.
Danke, Oma.
Bitte. Dann machen wir Schluss.